Belgium. I'm Katie Glenn Bass. I'm going to quickly introduce our panelists and then get right into the discussion. So first, to my right, we have Deray McKesson, who is a civil rights activist, a community organizer, and the host of an excellent podcast on Crooked Media called Pod Save the People. He is a leading voice in the Black Lives Matter movement, and he's also the co-founder of Campaign Zero, which is a policy platform to end police violence. His book, On the Other Side of Freedom, The Case for Hope, will be published in September 2018. Next to him is Jill Abramson, a journalist who spent the last 17 years in the most senior editorial positions at the New York Times. She was the first woman to serve as their Washington bureau chief, their managing editor, and their executive editor. She is the author of three books, and her fourth, called Merchants of Truth, The Business of Facts, and The Future of News, will be out in January 2019. And finally, we have Jose Antonio Vargas, who is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, an Emmy-nominated filmmaker, and a leading voice for the human rights of immigrants. He's the founder and CEO of Define American, the nation's leading nonprofit media and culture organization that fights injustice and anti-immigrant hate. His forthcoming memoir, called Dear America, Notes of an Undocumented Citizen, will be published in September 2018. So it's truly an all-star lineup today, and you should all buy your books when you're So I'm going to kick it right off with a little bit of scene setting, because this panel has the intentionally provocative title of Can Free Speech Be Saved? But one thing I've found is that increasingly people are not talking about the same thing or thinking about the same thing when they think of free speech. For some people, what comes to mind is protest rights, which are under attack at the state level and also seen in the continued prosecution in D.C. of 58 protesters from Inauguration Day who faced serious charges, including conspiracy or riot. Other people will think of the relentless attacks on the media by the president, by his supporters, and by many other political officials, up to and including referring to journalists as the enemy of the people. And for an alarming number of other people, what comes to mind when you say free speech is white supremacists, who trot that phrase out as an attempt to paint themselves as noble defenders of the First Amendment. So there's a lot to discuss right there. But even after we clarify what we mean when we talk about free speech, asking whether free speech can be saved raises the question of whether it needs saving. In some ways, free speech feels pretty robust right now. Social media platforms allow for more participation in public debate by more people in our society than we would have thought possible 15 years ago. Newspaper subscriptions are up. The New York Times and the Washington Post are engaged in a daily battle to outscoop one another. People who may never have considered themselves political before 2016 are starting to educate themselves about issues, to engage in activism, and even to run for office. So having set that out, my first question for each of you is, does free speech need saving? Is it in distress? And if so, what do you think is the biggest threat from your view? Dre, can I start with you?
You know, it's always interesting to talk about free speech because I remember those early days in St. Louis where nothing seemed very free. And you know, you remember us marching in the streets in Ferguson, is that it was illegal to stand still in August, September, and October of 2014, and that if we stood still for more than 5 seconds, we were arrested. So when you saw us marching, it wasn't that we thought marching was a particularly cool thing to do, it was the only thing that we could do because we couldn't stand still. And I start there because there's no way for me to think about free speech without thinking about the severe imbalance in power, that free speech is an incredible idea until the conversation about enforcement comes into play. And what we see is that when brown bodies and black bodies start to think about free speech or speech is free, then the enforcement thing is like a real challenge. So in Charlottesville, we saw the white supremacists like actually push the police and do all these things. And if we had done that, you know, I'd be an afterthought in a really cool sort of mural somewhere. But you saw them do it, and it was like free speech. You're like, I don't even know, like that. I've never seen speech be that free. So when I think about it, for me, it's like I don't know how to talk about the idea of free speech without talking about the practice of enforcement. And what we see with the practice of enforcement is where the power imbalance is just so stark, especially when black and brown bodies are put on the line. And like that, to me, is like the only worthy space to talk about with this conversation.
Well, I think my answer is going to be a nuanced one. And I preface any remarks I give by saying I am thrilled to be here as a representative of the enemy of the people. But, you know, in some ways we are literally drowning in speech, especially when you talked about social media. And certainly a concern that I have is the survival of foster civilized discourse. So I don't, I'm not worried that, you know, we're losing speech, but I'm worried that quality discourse is being drowned out. The ARC and RISE, you know, Facebook and other social media platforms that you mentioned in your introduction, so important. I mean, sometimes you just have to stop and think about, you know, the past 10 years and what didn't exist 10 years ago and what exists now. And, you know, my book, you know, Merchants of Truth, is very much about the narrative arc of those 10 years, and Facebook is a major character in that drama. And what I worry about is, you know, everyone's focus on fake news, you know, the Russian bots, the fake, you know, Russian hatch, Black Lives Matter sites on Twitter and Facebook. All of that is terrible, but I'm scared that in the rush to reform and regulate that kind of manipulation, that we're going to see calls by the government in Washington and also overseas in Europe to regulate. And I have a real watch my wallet feeling about that. I tend to be a pretty much pure free speech kind of journalist. And so those calls are making me nervous right now.
Okay, great. And we're going to come back to the online space questions.
I just have to say, so I grew up in newsrooms. I've been working in newsrooms since I was 16. I just have to really acknowledge how many glass ceilings Jill Abramson has broken in journalism, and the fact that I'm sitting next to her, so I just wanted to say that. As I sit here, there are not a lot of women in charge of news organizations. I would argue that if more women were in charge, it'd be different, in the same way that I would argue that if there were more people with immigrant backgrounds running American newsrooms, we would also have a different conversation about immigration. I have to say, by the way, I was really struck by the introductory video about words transcending borders. Just because, you know, I've been in this country since I was 12, and I can't physically leave the country, so I'm kind of stuck. I don't want to use that word. But this book that I ended up working on is probably the closest I get to being free in that way. The fact that it can go to my mom in the Philippines, and it can... So when you talk about free speech, I think about, totally right, Jill, about how there's so much of it. I didn't realize this really until I started traveling the country. I've done maybe like 1,000 events in 48 states, about as many Tea Party conservative events as I possibly could, just so they can face this illegal alien who's also gay in front of them, and they're totally confused. You're not from Mexico? No, I'm not. Why do you speak English? English so good? I don't know, I read The New Yorker when I was a kid. And speech, in terms of how people understand people like me, is because they have had, since like the 90s, the rise of Fox News, and the lies that have been told about us. I did an event with Bill Moyers last year at the New York Public Library, and he said, never underestimate how a lie can organize people and sustain itself. And I would argue that we are where we are because of all the lies that we have been telling, not just immigrants, but people of color in this country, right? Like, for me, the most important word, even in this book that I just did, is the word citizen, right? Like, how do you define citizenship? Like, I don't have citizenship because I was not born here, I don't have papers, but for me, words and the freedom of our freedom to express ourselves is in itself a kind of citizenship. And how we practice it, right, with as much, not just nuance, but understanding that we gotta hear each other. That's the problem. There's so much speech, but we are actually not interested in hearing each other. We're not even on the same page about so many of these issues.
Great. Well said. Jose, that leads well into a question that I wanted to ask you. So this idea of, on the one hand, more people are participating in debates than maybe ever have before in some senses through social media. On the other side, you know, when you make the case for free speech, when I make the case for free speech, you kind come back to these underlying values of fostering a robust public debate and sort of the tired cliche of the marketplace of ideas. But when you look at public discourse today, it's also clear that not everyone has equal access to that public debate. And I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about the intersection of free speech issues and the immigration policy debate, which takes place in this country without the voices of many of the people who are most affected by those policies. Your new book talks about lying, passing, and hiding. I'm wondering if you can go into a little more detail about that.
And a part of that is, I had to lie to be in newsrooms, right? I lied about my immigration status so I can be in the Washington Post and the San Francisco Chronicle, so I can write for New York. And so I own up to that because that's true, that's what I had to do. I have to say, though, that I have had the privilege to be able to do that, to have been able to pass. Like, I meet so many people who say, because of my accent or because of the color of my skin, I could not have passed in the same way you passed, right? The moment I found out I was here legally, the first thing I did was get rid of my Filipino accent. And thank God for PBS and hip hop. I was like, I gotta sound like Dr. Dre, and then I gotta go sound like Bill Moyers. If I can do both of those things, no one is gonna question where I'm from, right? But how many people do that? I am struck when I travel the country at the fact that how many people consider the word illegal synonymous with Mexican. I'm so struck by that. There are 33 million Mexicans in this country, the majority of whom are here, and many of them were here before this was the United States of America. And now we have had a culture, a media culture, right, in which that kind of connection has been made, right? So for us, the access to freedom of speech and even the way the newspapers frame this conversation. And again, for me, it's been really personal because, I'm a child of newsrooms. And so to see my colleagues in the news industry, particularly on television, do such a disservice to this issue and not connect the dots, right? In this country today, there are 43 million immigrants. I don't know if you know that. 43 million immigrants, 11 million of whom are undocumented. In the next 50 years, according to Pew, I'm a journalist, I like numbers, in the next 50 years, 88% of the total US population growth is gonna come from those 43 million immigrants. So you can't talk about immigration and not talk about the fact that this is actually the America that we're talking about now. And yet, for the most part, immigration is framed as a political issue. Most of the articles, right, and most of the coverage in Morning Joe is always about what this politician is doing that, in the book, actually, I talk about how many journalists I talk to, my own colleagues, who are like, so you just can't get legal? That's the number one question, right? Bill Maher is not gonna like this, but it's in the book, whatever. You're right, like, what do you mean you can't just get legal? What, do I just turn on a light switch or something? Is this how this works? But the fact that people don't even know that, right? And again, back to what Bill Moyer said, the lies that have been told about this, and the fact that we haven't really corrected them. And our job in the news media is how do we do that? With people who already have their own prism, right? The Fox News people, the Breitbart people, the Drudge people.
Well, it's hard to do that, I think, in a space where, as you all were saying, civil discourse is basically non-existent. Or maybe I'm wrong about that, so that's one thing I wanted to ask you directly.
I don't want to buy into that it's non-existent, but I think that what Jose was beginning to explore in depth is that, especially on television, especially on cable television, which so reflects the extreme polarization of the country right now, into extreme right with Fox News, and the left with MSNBC and Rachel, et cetera, that you have a media culture that thrives on conflict, constant conflict, which is why, when you say there's such ignorance about policy issues like immigration, it's because that doesn't fit into that, like, have four, experts on a panel screaming at each other, which is what is the staple of cable TV. I think that at least, I've spent nearly 3 years in researching my book, going in depth to tell the stories of four different news organizations and how they sort of adapted to the digital revolution over the past And I really came away admiring all four of them. And I think all four are struggling in different ways, using different platforms to deliver quality news in a way that honors civil discourse and the intelligence of readers and viewers. Mm-hmm. So that's still there. But because the audience is so atomized and so polarized, yep. and because of what Jose was saying, that you know, people on opposing ends of the spectrum don't really want to hear each other, and the way the media gets delivered now on your Facebook feed, the way the algorithm works, is if you don't want to hear, you don't have to, mm-hmm. and most people don't.
Right.
So we're in a world where everyone is kind of existing in their own echo chamber, self-selected, rarely exposed to original thinking that is challenging the world that we believe. And that's a big problem.
Yeah, I think that's right. So speaking of echo chambers and screaming at each other, I want to talk about Twitter. And DeRay, I was wondering what your take on this is. I remember following your Twitter feed back in 2014 during the Ferguson protests and being really struck at how much work you were doing to educate people and also to document what was happening there in real time. And it felt to me like a real mobilization. Like I was watching other people on Twitter react to you and to the other people on the ground who were doing that work, who were really learning something. And for a lot of people, I think, experiencing or understanding for the first time what many people of color in this country go through every
day. Most people didn't even know there was Black Twitter.
Right, also true. And I'm wondering, you know, do you think online spaces have changed in the last few years? Is there still room to reach people who don't know about this stuff, who are unconvinced, or is it more an echo chamber than it used to be?
Yeah, I think about, you know, I have a complicated relationship with Twitter. The first person ever permanently banned from Twitter was banned for raising money to try to get me killed. And I think about that, and I think about using it as a platform that in so many ways saved our lives. And if we had not had Twitter, Missouri would have tried to convince you that we just didn't exist in August of 2014, and that was incredibly important. You know, I used to teach sixth grade math. I taught here in Brooklyn, and sixth grade is by far the best grade. If you've ever been around seventh graders, you know it is a nightmare. Seventh grade is puberty and deodorant, but sixth grade is like still a lot of magic. And I started there because the cool thing about sixth grade is that they still believe. And but I taught really long classes. I taught 120-minute classes to 11-year-olds, which is a whole lot of math for a sixth grader. And one day they were like, "Miss McKesson, can I go to gym early?" And I'm like, "Absolutely, I'm tired of you. You're tired of me." And they come back really quick, and I'm like, "Why are you guys back?" And when I realize that they're in love with the idea of gym more than the work of gym, and I think in this moment, people are more in love with the idea of resistance than the work of resistance. And I say that because when I think about Twitter, in the beginning, it was like a platform that was squarely about the work for us, right? Like, I can move 5,000 people to the mall really quickly. I can, like, mobilize this thing. I can tell people to show up at the police department, blah. And in some ways, it's become a platform where people sort of just like talk about ideas all day. It's like a sort of rhetorical commitment and rhetorical revolutionaries. And you're like, well, what's the work look like, right? And it's one of the things that led me to the book, this idea that language is often the first way that power is distributed and redistributed. And like, how do we own that? The way we talk about the world that we live in, the way we talk about the things that we talk about actually matters. So it's like, why in the protests we never talk about police brutality anymore? We only talk about police violence. Because we want people to think about the violence of the police as a consistent thing, and brutality makes it seem sort of episodic, right? So the language that we use is like really intentional about those things. And like in the book, talking about like this sort of simple truth, so a third of all the people killed by a stranger in this country is actually killed by a police officer. 1 in 11 homicides in California is done by an officer, right? So how do we start to talk about the truth and sort of tell it in a story in a way that is actually just like really simple? Because what we would say is that truth is so damning, it should radicalize you. And like Twitter was the platform that allowed us to believe that our stories matter, because we didn't need anybody to believe in us besides like regular people. Like, I didn't need the news to like me. I didn't need the Washington Post to write about me. Like, as long as people followed what we were doing and like responded to it, we could actually change everything. And that proved to be powerful. The difference today is, like, you remember 4 years ago, there was no, like, Twitter video, there was no Periscope. Like, I remember when Jack, and I write about this a little bit, when Jack
worker in the world is now trained and knows that step one is no longer like your notebook and calling sources. Step one is putting it out on Twitter. And that expectation on the part of the audience to know everything the instant it happens is like a profound change in the way information.
It's true. And that's something striking in your book is you give a really gripping account of how destructive in many ways the internet has been for quality journalism. And I'm interested, do you or Jose, do you see a vision where the internet can actually support financially and otherwise quality journalism? Is there a way back from where we are now?
You know, I was really lucky in the industry because I grew up when it was transitioning. Mm-hmm. So to see it, my first job was I was the person that carried the proofs when there were proofs to like the people that were actually mocking them up. So that was like my high school experience to now where we are. And to see this job of facilitating and framing the conversation for me is where I find social media the most useful and the most destructive at the same time, right? Let me give you an example of this, because you know, we're talking about free speech. So when I travel around the country and people ask me why I'm here, right? So I'm a journalist, I'm trained, I turn the question around, why are you here? Right? Because unless you're a Native American, unless you're an African American who was imported here to build this country for free, you came from somewhere. What papers did you have? Right? And so when you talk about things like manifest destiny, white man's burden, why is it that white people throughout history could just move? And yet people of color, when we move, the question is it legal? Is it a crime? That's a framing question, right? Like, I'm staggered by how much media there is on immigration, yet so little inquiry on the how and the why. Like, why are people here? What does NAFTA have to do with it? when the foreign policy of this country, especially after the Cold War, right, were going after these, you know, quote unquote, you know, what we were doing in Central America, right? Like, what impact did that have? So when for me, the fact that people are using social media to kind of redefine and reframe the conversation is what I find really subversive and necessary. However, they get drowned out, right? Like, in this country, you know, we talk about America, we talk about America in such a simplified way, and I think we are now living through the consequences of the oversimplification.
Well, don't you think that? Sorry to keep
jumping in.
I'm not the moderator. But, you know, a big reason for that, I think, is, you know, we're a little bit, you know, ignoring the elephant in the room when we're talking about Twitter. We have, you know, the tweeter in chief is Donald Trump, who's more skilled at using Twitter, and especially on the issue of immigration,
yes.
I would add. And he has become, you know, I worry about this, that of course the press has to cover what the president says or tweets, but he has just so dominated and taken up so much oxygen, and so much of the news coverage has become reactive,
yes,
to Donald Trump's tweets, that when you talk about framing, I think that's so important.
It's a really
important concept, but the framer in chief is the president right now. And as long as that's true, it's very hard to get into these deeper layers of meaning and information that we're all about.
But how do we do that in this era? How do we do that? Like, what does that look like? And again, for me, echo chamber, you know, again, I don't think I could have survived in this country if I wasn't trained as a journalist. Meaning my life was talking to people who did not share my system of reality. That was my job, to follow Sarah Palin around in 2007, right? So in doing the work that I do now, I probably bent over backwards trying to make sure that I understand why people think I'm some sort of an alien and a criminal, that somehow my presence here is a danger to the American democracy. I really want to understand why that is, right? And what, why are they holding on to
but
that?
But don't you think that Trump's
absolutely.
I'm not saying it's the only reason,
but
it certainly is.
The heart,
it's
part of the
heart.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I'd say what's interesting about Trump is that it's not just Trump is like the framing, but it's also this conversation about what whiteness and white supremacy does, is that when the choice of whiteness is that it creates these constructs that damage everybody else but itself. So what Trump does really well is this idea that like, or what the media does to Trump is this idea that every position is, that like we should take into account both sides and every issue and every idea is and every idea is like worthy of exploration and those sort of things. And that is like tied whiteness works in the world is that there aren't really two sides to racism, right? Like there's like a good and bad side. Those are like the only two sides. There aren't like two sides to white supremacy. And when Obama was president, we saw that this idea of like everything is equally whatever was not that, you know, people called him a liar all the time. People called out his policies and his, but when we see Trump do it, it's like it's the way that whiteness actually works, is that like every sort of opinion is like a valid thing and like we should take it at face value. You saw that report at the New York Times, who like wouldn't call him a liar, like she, whatever phrase she used, that was like not liar. But like that is one of the ways that whiteness continues to work. So when you think about this conversation about race, it's like how do we name the way that whiteness is working so that we can also like deconstruct it and show people what's happening? And Charlottesville, again, to me, is still one of the single best examples. I remember talking to Terry McAuliffe, the governor of Virginia, right after that, and he said that, because I'm like, why didn't the police, you know, those white people push the police, and I push the police officer again, it'd be lights out. And he was like, Dre, they stockpile weapons across the city. I'm like, that is crazy, right? Like, if people had ever thought that we had stockpiled weapons in Ferguson, that would have been like national news immediately. It was like the dangerous black people ready to kill everybody. But in Charlottesville, it became sort of like part of their free speech. It was like, well, this is sort of just what it means to be a citizen. And like, this is sort of a valid way to push and pride. And like, there's no way to acknowledge that without also acknowledging the way that whiteness works. And like, one of the ways that whiteness works is it creates these constructs that like play by a set of rules that it never has to play by. And like, we see that time and time again. I think Trump is probably the best example of that in real time.
I would add to that though. So I made a documentary on TV called White People. It's on YouTube, you can check it out. Because my interest in making that film was to really interrogate, you know, like before you got here, you were something else. Right? This is what Toni Morrison taught me when I was a kid. Like, this idea that whiteness was created to define what was not black, right? These people were Germans, Latvians, Irish before they got here, right? So for me, having, you know, done the documentary and speaking to a lot of conservative white people, I would argue that they don't even know what whiteness is. And the toughest part of this is people of color always having to educate white people on what that is, right?
They don't have to know what it is to benefit from.
Well, but that's the thing. They don't know that they're benefiting from it. And for me, though.
But you say you have spent quality time, and I have at, you know, white dominated meetings of all types, that what is so palpable and interesting to me is that they see whiteness as being under mortal threat.
Yes, absolutely.
That
absolutely.
Find,
well, you know, I mean, progressive circles call it white fragility or we're pacifying white people.
It was,
people,
you
or,
know, a big part of like Trump's support, mm-hmm, and the huge turnout, you know, that was unanticipated and underappreciated by even the New York Times,
yep,
or the Washington Post in 2016, was this wave of anger among older white voters and the turnout among that, and, you know, those parts of America was huge. You know, whereas unfortunately, you know, black turnout in key states like Michigan and Wisconsin was down more than 10%.
Because of like voter disenfranchisement.
Right. No, I get why, but I'm just saying there was this explosion of anger by, you know, the white majority feeling, you know, that profoundly sort of ill at ease and in backlash mode after 8 years of the Obama presidency.
Well, let's unpack that a little more too, and the media's role in framing and sort of the conversation we've been having here. So one thing that I see Sherilyn Eiffel, who is the head of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, say sometimes is that it frustrates her that the media won't call a thing a thing. So they won't call racism racism.
racism. They won't call Trump a racist, or a lot of them won't. They'll say racially inflammatory or controversial comments. You see it. I mean, there are a number of examples. It's not every media outlet, but there are a number of media outlets that are like,
I can't sit still.
Okay.
Because, you know, BuzzFeed, which, you know, I'm looking at the audience, I don't feel this is a target BuzzFeed audience. It's
right. I don't want to stereotype.
We don't know, it's true. But the Ben Smith, the editor of BuzzFeed, back in January of 2016, at the very beginning of the primaries, he said it is fine to write about Donald Trump and call him a demagogue and a racist. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's true in the past couple of days that the incident that Dre was just talking about, where Maggie Haberman didn't use the word lie and got a sale for it. Well, I am sorry, but the New York Times was one of the first to use the word Trump and lies in a headline. Dean Baquet made that decision. It was brave. It was the right decision in the summer of 2016.
Yeah, but bravery is about how you show up every time. It's not about how you just show up.
I'm sorry. I think if you look at the Times' coverage, that they don't.
I don't know. It's not courageous to like do it once, right?
Well, they've done it more than once. Like, I'm sorry.
I don't think we're trying to single out the New York Times necessarily.
And by the way, that most of the country doesn't care about the New York Times. I mean, I know this. Which is right. Like, when I'm like going to communities,
but
I'm like,
it's
that's
just,
not.
I'm just taking exception to the idea that everybody decides to wear.
I worry about, even though when we talk about like unconscious bias, it's like the Starbucks incident seemed pretty conscious to me. Right? Like, I don't know what the unconscious part of that was, right? And I think that we like let people off the hook too easily. And it's like, Trump does things that his intent sort of notwithstanding, the impact is just so disparate that it's like, I refuse to believe that like you don't understand that. And like us, our inability or unwillingness to just call it out every time, even if it sounds like a broken record, is a choice. And that like part of what I think we have to do is like continue to name that like people are choosing to do this. And I don't think we should compromise on that.
There are various news organizations that regularly do a tally of the lies of Donald Trump.
Well, I'm also not that. The lie thing is easy now because everything's like, there's so few things that aren't lies. That's sort of like an easy one. It's the race part that I think is like, still seems to be like hard for people. You're like, I don't know why this is.
Did you feel after Charlottesville? I thought that was pretty immediate.
But that's like easy. It's like the girl got killed. It's like they're like white supremacists pushing the police. Like that's sort of like a. It's like to not call you racist at that moment makes you racist, right? Like that's sort of like a. That's like a weird thing. You look crazy after that. It's the stuff being like calling for the death penalty for drug dealers that is like. You know, we arrest more people for weed than all violent crimes combined in this country. Like that. That's sort of like a. There's no way to talk about that without talking about racism, what I sort of offer.
I guess there's something that must be said about trust. So whom people trust. Like for example, right now, every day, just because I give my number to so many immigration advocates, so whenever someone's about to get deported, I usually get like a little alert, right? And most of these people don't go to the Des Moines Register or the local NPR affiliate. They go to Univision or they go to Daily. And the fact that, because those are the news organizations that think of their issue as a human issue and not as what is Donald Trump's comment on what that is, right? So I think the trust factor here is really important, like whom news consumers decide is actually there for them, right? And what that looks like. Some people may call that advocacy. Some people may just call it public service, like public service journalism, right? And I have to say though, like I think this is why I'm fascinated with what your book is gonna be about, Jill, because what is the new model for this? Like what this accountability journalism looks like at the local level when stuff really happens.
Okay.
Right?
No, it's a vital question. Yep. And you know, for the conclusion of my book, this is just 2 weeks ago, there was actually a free speech or pro-press demonstration outside of, you all know, the Lipstick Building at 53rd and 3rd. There's, you know, a hedge fund that has offices in that building that have bought up a lot of what used to be regional and local quality newspapers, like the Denver Post, yeah, for example. And, you know, they've just been, the size of their staff has just reduced, so that I went out there, in Denver, I think 2 years ago, and, was introduced to their investigative editor, who, was 1 year out of college, and I said, oh, how many reporters do you have, reporting to you? Like, one, to cover the whole state. That, local governments are not being covered, or, the role of the press is to hold government and powerful institutions accountable. Forget about it in many localities. And that's a real crisis. And slowly, on the bright side, because, I'm basically an optimist about, the survival of quality information and of local news. Slowly, digital news organizations and ones that are more reflective of the communities that are looking for what's going on and wanting to see themselves in coverage are sprouting up, but not fast enough. And when you ask the question, which I think you started to ask a while ago, is like, how do we pay for it? That's like, that's the continuing drumbeat that there's a wolf at the door in the narrative of the book that I wrote over the past 10 years. The wolf is like, the business model is dying. Digital advertising is pennies compared to print advertising and the kind of money that used to keep newspapers alive at the state and local level. And so, what I think we're gonna have to look to, and we're starting to see develop at all different levels, is in terms of digital news, is reader revenue. The news and information has to be of such a quality that people feel, I need this, and this speaks to me, and I want it, and I think slowly they're showing they will pay for it.
This gets back to what Larry was talking about telling stories, right? Like, I've stopped using the word diversity about this, and more about representation, right? Like, the reality is most news organizations in this country do not reflect the communities they cover. They just do not, right? Because of outreach, a big pipeline problem, right? This is a big issue in the documentary filmmaking world. And I think this issue of who gets to tell whose story and who gets to define whose narrative, to me, is of absolute importance. Yeah. And I think that's where we gotta get really uncomfortable. I would argue, by the way, that we are where we are because too many of us have gotten too comfortable. And what I mean by that is a lot of white people have gotten too comfortable. And in my opinion, I think we have to share the uncomfortability. If we're gonna go anywhere, if we're actually gonna solve some of the, not solve, but actually really address and interrogate these questions, it's gonna get really uncomfortable, right? But I think we have to be willing to get there and to be uncomfortable in that way.
I'd say, I'm not a reporter, and I spend so much of my time dealing with sort of people who are trying to get these stories told in bigger places, and we're trying to use our platform to do it. I think about, I got this DM, a lot of stuff happens in the DMs, and I got this DM once from somebody who worked at the morgue in a major city in America, and he's like, Dorea, a body just came in. I think the police killed this guy, but it's going to get washed away. Can you help me connect with a reporter who can cover this, right? So I DM this other reporter who covered this other story about police violence, and like, we're all in this DM chain, and like, this reporter's now following the story about this body that came in. And I think about so many of those sort of things, because it does matter to me as somebody who's trying to connect people. It matters that like the newspaper like tells the truth about race, right? That their like angle and coverage is actually like one that sort of makes any sense. And I'm not questioning whether I'm gonna like turn in, they're gonna like turn in this guy, Like, that's actually really important to us. When we think about these issues around justice, it is so many reporters who like don't realize that they have a ton of power. And like in Sierra Leone, Alabama, where Shakisha was just beat up at the Waffle House, it's like I'm calling a random reporter being like, do you know anybody who's ever sued the police department? Like, have you ever written about that? Because if you can put me in touch with a lawyer, then I can probably get a copy of the use of force policy because they probably got it when they sued them. And it's like, these sort of people become them helping us connect the dots in a way that's just different. And even with the Vegas shooting, I remember tweeting about it when it first happened, and like this doctor DM'd me the next day, and she was like, your tweet was the first tweet I saw about it anywhere. She's like, I saw it and I went right to the hospital and I got there before any of the victims came. And it's like, Twitter has become this sort of thing for us that allowed us to like open up space that just didn't exist before, that allowed us to push systems and structures and like get people to respond in ways that they could otherwise choose not to. And I think about that when I think about this question about free speech, it is a question about like free for who. And what happens when you like don't teach a generation of people how to read and write? Like it's not, like I don't know what free speech looks like. Or I was on a panel with somebody from ACLU, and he, you know that under free speech it's not covered if it incites violence. And I'm like, well, there's all this stuff that like is a history of inciting lynching and all this stuff that's not like so far past, right? And the guy that ACLU literally says, he says, DeRay, well, when was the last lynching? And I was like, is that really your response? You're the ACLU guy. Like, is that really your response? But it's a question, and this goes back to what Jose was saying, is like, what does it look like when the people who are the defenders actually will never be disadvantaged by the decision, right? So they're gonna be, he's gonna be fine, right? Like no matter what the hate speech looks like or that, he's not gonna be attacked. And with the reporting on Trump, it's like, you don't have to really call a lie because like you're not being deported, your family's not gonna be charged with a hate crime. Like you're not actually implicated in any of this stuff. So how do we start to talk about the importance of proximity so people start to feel implicated in the way they tell the story so that actually like matters, because it does matter to so many people.
That's a great point. Okay, we are fast approaching the end of our time together, so I am going to invite the audience, anyone who has a question, there are two mics sort of midway through the room. Please go up to the mics. And please try to keep 10 to actual questions and relatively concise. Thank you.
Hi. Okay. First of all, Ray, I love you and I love your podcast. Thank you. I am a deeply liberal person living in Chicago, but I'm from the South. And in talking about the echo chambers, I try to keep people in my life who are devastating to my relationships. And I had a friend of mine once said, well, you don't touch a stove just to make sure that it's still hot. So what do you do in terms of wanting to get all the information and wanting to get both sides, but also wanting to keep your own personal safety? Sanity.
Yeah, I'm just not convinced part of my work has to be convincing my bully that I'm like a real person, right? That like, the people who voted for Trump know why they voted for Trump. I don't need to like go out and be like, hi, I'm black, and like, don't hate me, and then like, that just seems like a futile sort of exercise to keep going on. The thing about echo chambers is like, in this idea of preaching to the choir, is that the choir needs rehearsal too. And the choir needs new music, and the choir needs to get tuned, and the choir needs to go perform, and the choir needs to grow. So when I think about how I spend my time, it's like making sure that the choir is the best choir we got, right? And that the choir is singing like the best song, the choir continues to grow, and that it's like fine-tuned and new music and like a new message every time. And I'm not even giving up on the other people, but that's like somebody else's work. Like I just don't think that's like my work in the moment. And like we should challenge, and we should like, if anything, it's like, how do we stop preaching and start making other people do the cognitive work? So I was on a panel once with a police officer, and she was like, DeRay, well, you know, the police have hard jobs. I'm like, well, I have a hard life. And she's like, you know, all this stuff. And I'm like, well, the police don't have to kill people. She's like, do you really think that? And I'm like, yeah. And I'm like, well, tell me when the police can kill your child. Like, tell me the circumstances. Like, what are the mistakes that your child should make that, like, the police can kill them? And she's like, I don't know. I'm like, well, I don't know either, right? And it was this effort of, like, how do I put the cognitive work back on you? So instead of me like killing myself, being like, this is wrong, and then it's like, you tell me when the police can kill a kid you love, and then I'm like, damn, right? And that's about like sharing the work, and I think too often, especially when we're morally right, we don't share the work, we take the burden of preaching, and the preach doesn't like actually change people's minds.
Okay. Other questions?
I'm also a flaming liberal. I'm 18, I'm an aspiring journalist. And my question was also sort of about the echo chamber thing. You were talking earlier about how there are sort of liberal echo chambers and also conservative ones on the side of Fox News, on this side, and then MSNBC with Rachel Maddow and things like that. Do you think that those issues of echo chambers are equal on both sides, or is it, or
I would say that it's more on the conservative side, but that's just me. You know, white supremacy and things like that, sort of what you're talking about with the whiteness, like the way, like what you were talking about, how when you create an echo chamber within white communities, that creates white supremacy. And then on the liberal side, there's not really, I don't feel like there's an equivalent, but I don't know what, what do you think about that?
I just have to say, by the way, having met so many people after the election who have said that they don't, white people who don't want to talk to their conservative relatives anymore, right? And I'm like, yo, if you're gonna not gonna talk to them, who's gonna talk to them? Like, I feel like we all need like a white convention where like the white liberals talk to the white conservatives and we all figure this out, right? Because it's getting to this point where, again, this the burden of having to carry not only educating you and proving my existence, I wish I could, you know, I wish I could be in a place where I don't care about my bully. I wish I could be there. I'm not there. Because a lot of it is, because I think, you know, a part of it too is because I have to seriously deal with the consequences of getting deported here, right? So like how, what envelopes to push and how much I can push and where. I have to say, as a journalist, facts and context is where I live. And then I have a friend, Clay Shirky, great guy, who said, Jose, you don't bring facts to a culture war? What are you doing, right? And so he really pushed me to think about facts matter, right? And I think when MSNBC, when Joy or Rachel, when they do what they do, a lot of that is based on the facts that they know and the context that they know. So the liberal echo chamber is, for me, at least, way more fact-based than the conservative echo chamber that is just not interested. But honestly, if I don't do as much Fox News as I do, then I'm not getting an email from the president of the Nebraska Chamber of Commerce who was like, young man, can you come to Nebraska and talk to my Chamber of Commerce people and bring your tax forms? How did you pay taxes? I'm like, I don't know, call the IRS, right? To me, by the way, let me just kind of state this plainly. Undocumented people are paying into the system that detains and deports us, right? Like that is a fact that not even the Washington Post and to some extent the New York Times has even really framed, which is that we actually contribute economically to this country, right? So I have to really question all of that. And then I get this argument with myself that the Ray just brought up about how much of it is, I don't want to have to explain my existence to you, but I know that you don't know what you don't know, and what you don't know is actually the difference between detention and deportation for me. So then where do we meet? Where do we meet, right? I got into journalism because I firmly believe that connection, right, as human beings is a solution for this, to understand what that is. And so I've been struggling with that, to try to figure out where the right balance is. I don't have the answers, but for me, I have to say, like, when I go on MSNBC, I know that I don't have to explain myself to Joy Reid. When I go on Tucker Carlson, I have to really prepare my eyebrows, right? And be like, okay, Jose, calm down. They're already confused that I look so Asian and my name is Jose Antonio Vargas, right? So like, my eyebrows are gonna confuse the shit out of them, so just relax. Don't be the angry illegal alien on television, right? So it takes a lot of work.
Your question about are they equal? Absolutely not. And you know, Fox has a much bigger audience. Fox has been a cash cow for incredible cash cow for Rupert Murdoch's media empire more broadly. But the one thing to keep in mind, this is true for liberal cable TV too. We're talking about audiences that are mainly over 65 years old. I mean, they're really, you know, the people who watch Fox all day long, and there are millions of them, but they're mostly seriously like hovering around 70 years old. So we're talking about like a whole important part of our population, young people who are sort of factored out of the cable news equation. None of them watch it. You know, in that space, there are much more diverse news media organizations that are reaching, you know, younger viewers and younger readers. But you know, the world of Fox News is really one that, you know, very, very few young people are even, you know, tuned into.
Yeah. And I just say very quickly, you know, Jose, it's not about that, that I am not acknowledging that the bully exists and worrying about it. It's that I don't think that that is like my job.
Yeah, no, I get that. I totally get that.
Just clarifying it. Oh, yeah, I think absolutely. About like when the officer had the gun in my face, he wasn't interested in me explaining my humanity to him, right? When I got dragged by my ankles out of the police department in St. Louis Metro, they weren't interested in like a deep conversation about race and justice, right? And I think that too often in this work, we get so hell-bent on like convincing the other side that that becomes so much of our work, as opposed to solidifying like the base and the language of the people who like support us and the people who like want to do the work and the people who are looking for another entrance and don't know a way in. And you think about things like Wisconsin, and we talk about even the language of saying people didn't vote. It's like, that makes it seem like they had a choice, right? And they didn't have a choice. Is that in Wisconsin, it's like the work there is like helping people realize like you got the power stripped away from you, right? And like we need to figure out how to build that choir so that you realize like you deserve this. Like people like screwed you over at scale, and like we need to figure that out. And I've seen in too many places, especially with activists, where people double down on this idea that like every idea is valid and da-da-da-da, we need to like talk to those people. It's like the people in Charlottesville weren't interested in like a deep conversation, right? And like we should just name that. And like Trump's a great example of like he is doubling down on the base. He's not living in a world where he's like on both sides and da-da-da-da. He's like base only. And the left is sort of this interesting thing where it's like the base is sort of like whatever, they're good people, but like let us reach across the aisle. It's like, what if the aisle is just playing you, right? Like, what if the aisle is like waiting for you to reach out so they can like string you along knowing that they're not gonna change their mind? And like that is what I get worried about. And I say that as somebody who's been on Fox and like I've been on all those things too. And there are people who come up to me and they're like, oh my God, you don't want to kill the police officers? I didn't even know. And you're like, oh my God.
Let's take one last question to wrap this up. Hi, I'm a librarian. I was formerly in a large urban public library. I left to run a small rural public library in Western North Carolina because we all know what they're doing in North Carolina. So your comment about who are whom when you're right spoke to me. I'm having a hard time because of how I look and the assumption that I'm a white Republican woman connecting with my community. And I want to be a better advocate and I want to be a better ally. And so I need some practical guidance and advice. Our small town paper, our turnover on reporters is a couple of months because they're straight out of school and then move on to a larger market. So it really is a boots on the ground situation, and it's me and maybe two or three other librarians, and we're kind of trying. And so really practical advice on how I can be a better advocate and ally.
I think the two things I'd say is that it's like the keep showing up, it's like the courage thing, right? That the courage is actually showing up every day when it's not cool and not fun and not exciting and nobody's looking and nobody cares. It's like that's what actually matters. And what you find in a lot of low-income places is that people come in because they're gonna save the world, they realize it's really hard and they leave, right? So people get used to the like, you're really just here for it, you're really here to write that cool paper and that really cool book, and then you're gonna go. And like, will you stay? I think it's like a real question. And like, will you do this sort of hard work? And the second is this idea of like, how well do you know the issues that you say you work on? And a lot of people who like consider themselves, like I can't tell you the number of after school programs I've been to where people like teaching math and they don't know anything about math. I'm like, oh my God, let these kids out of here. You're like, oh my God, you don't know anything about this stuff. Or they're teaching reading and like I've never actually seen a kid learn how to read before. And you're like, and that's actually a thing that only works in low-income communities. Like it would never be okay for you to like swoop into a white neighborhood and like know nothing and just like be a service provider. But in low-income communities, it's this idea that like they just need everything. So like the fact that your body actually matters, and like the more skills you have that you actually are sharing because it's the right thing to do and not looking for like congratulations and da da da. Like people experience that even if they don't like tell you every day.
I think a part of it too is people want to see themselves. Like so, what the programming looks like. I have to tell you, especially in North Carolina, Georgia, and Arkansas. So many of people who want to become citizens, or can become citizens, the library is like the place to get all the training they got. And I have to say this, as a kid, who I wouldn't be who I am if I didn't have the public library. And
it's so also where an awful lot of people can still actually find the printed newspaper.
Yes. So I just think the library for me is like a church. I think it's like a church for communities. And I think anything we can do so people can feel like they're welcomed in the church, I think is important.
I would just add, you just the way you asked your question, I would think that you yourself, especially because of how you look, would be a very effective source for journalists covering the various issues that have been so controversial in North Carolina, that you shouldn't hide. You should connect with the reporters in your community so they know you and will go to you and view you as a reliable, truthful source. And you can be very effective at an activist by being heard and seen.
Yep.
And the last thing I know, the last thing I'll say is that like the best teachers do is that they work, when teachers walk into the classroom, the best teachers remind students that the gift already existed before the teacher got there, right? And what the teacher does is like help them find the gift every day. They'll be able to find that gift when the teacher's gone. What the work teachers do is make people believe that the gift only exists in their presence. And like what the best activists and the best community leaders do is that they remind people like you already had, like you had something special and you have something special. And what I'm here to do is like help you access that every single day. And like what you find in low-income communities is that it's a whole lot of love and not a lot of skill. So people like love, it's like a basketball program, breakfast, dinner, and like no actual skill, right? Like what you want to do is like help people like develop a set of skills that they'll have way when you're gone, right? They'll have them way after you're not there. Like the skill actually matters. And again, I've been to a number of after school and whatever programs are like, it's 90% love, a whole lot of love, and like nothing else. And we never do that for white kids. White kids are going skiing and getting science, right? Black kids are